And just know that every month, Marilyn O'Neill drives here from Bernie, Texas, just to be in your presence and teach you everything that you do and do not need to do when you're writing contracts, who's the don'ts in the legal industry part of being a realtor. I promise to prepare, and you can get cooler here in just a little bit. So it's required that you guys are in this class every month. You only come once a month, so this needs to be in your calendar. We always let you know a month in advance, or roughly at least a couple weeks, what day she'll be here, okay? And I promise she doesn't bite, so you can make your way to the front, so you can get some really handle.
I always call on the people in the back of the room.
I definitely, we checked and see what agents attended this class, so make sure you definitely sign in. And then also too, please come up to the front and get your handouts. And the reason why we have you sign in is because if there's ever a situation that you learn in this class and you do not come, we let you know this is why you need to come to these classes. Particularly Maryland classes, this is the only required class for all agents, new and experienced. Okay, so thank you so much. It means a lot to me that you are here at the Maryland.
I've been up since 2 o'clock this morning. Every time I get such early in the morning, I have to, you know, I don't rest. I'm thinking because my clock set right on my cell phone, you know, all these things. So I've been up since 2 o'clock, so I may be asleep by 2. But I'm going to talk to you about some issues that have come up in the last month, and I need you to be aware of them. They're not meant to scare you. They're really meant to empower you with knowledge and information. But they're in light of these changes that are coming October 3rd. We have a lot of issues. I talked to you last time about some of them, but I need to explain some of the things that are going on in the lending process. And so I'll open up and I'll talk to you all about that
before we get into the call. Come on in, guys. I need everybody to please sign in and come and also get your required documents, your handouts. Your teammates are here. And this is also being recorded, so you can also view this later. Give us about 2 days so we can upload it to the office internet. If you need to go back and revisit it, or have your assistant look at it, whatever the case may be, we are definitely recording all of Maryland's compliance classes, which again, I cannot stress enough. Every month, this class is different, every month. So I heard somebody say yesterday, no, I don't need to be there, I was there last month. Don't have that mindset that her classes are different every month, and they're here to benefit your office, to keep you from getting sued, and then also too, her job is to keep you abreast of everything that is going on at all times, with our documents, with track forms, with the law, etc. So she's extremely valuable to you. So thank you again for being here.
Thank you. First thing we're going to talk about is appraisals. And the reason that I'm mentioning these things is because in light of this October 3rd and the provisions that are coming in under this bill resolution, the lenders and the appraisers have all been very heightened on making sure that everything is correct and going on perfectly with the appraisal, that no, there's no interference in the appraisal. Let me tell you what's going on from the underwriter standpoint. This is how you know that this is the first time in lending history that lenders are on the chopping block. We're on the chopping block from the moment we engage with our clients, right? But the lenders are very sensitive to this now because this is really the first time that these federal mandates carry such burdensome fines. If the lender fails to do something or stop a process or notify something's going on, same way with the appraisers. The appraisers are being very sensitive to this. Let me explain what happened. We had a transaction where the appraiser went out and appraised a property. It appraised for about $1,500 more than the sell price. Okay? Buyer and seller were very happy. Everything was good. It goes to underwriting. You know how it goes into the underwriting process towards the very end? You know, they don't do this ahead of time. They kind of do it at the end, right before closing. So the underwriter gets a hold of it. The underwriter says, I don't like this appraisal. The underwriter said this. So they go back, and the underwriter requested from the first appraiser to reevaluate the appraisal. Sure enough, based on the challenges by the underwriter, appraiser number one reevaluated, now came in $4,000 less. So what happened then, now again, this is a little concerning because this is an underwriter function. The underwriter actually read the appraisal. Okay, so you see the difference. This is not a process that they're going to go by very slightly. This is serious. The underwriter read the appraisal, saw something in the appraisal, felt that it had not been reflected in the appraisal, and they challenged them based on their comparables. The underwriter actually looked at the comparables to the subject property, and they said this was way too far away. So, what happened is then the underwriter, now, by this point, the buyer and seller were real happy because it had net value. Actually, $1,500 over, so everything was good to go. Then when the appraiser number one readjusted the appraisal value, and it's now $4,000 less, the buyer and seller reached an amendment, agreed upon an adjustment. Each one contributed. They split the difference is what they did, okay? So they had an agreed upon amendment. They sent it to the lender and to the title company. The seller felt really good, got all their things in a moving van, and left. Then the underwriter looks at it and says, I'm going to order another field appraisal. So now the problem is you see appraiser number one was asked to adjust their appraisal. So there were two appraisals done, the first one and then the one that they adjusted it. The game was for low sales price. And then the underwriter asked for a field appraisal. Well, the request goes to this appraisal management company, and then they go out there and they ask appraisers, will you bid on this and do the appraisal? Well, the lender was getting a little nervous, not the underwriter, the lender, the loan officer. And so the lender kept calling this appraisal management company and said, look, my people need to know, based on this requirement by the underwriter, when is this other appraisal going to be done? And the lender was pretty upset, and so it was calling quite a bit. The lender was notified that the lender had interfered in the appraisal process. They set up the flag and stopped the process. I told you last month about the listing agents who had just said something very nonchalant about value, and it sent a red flag up, and the other one wanted to tell them about an appraisal that had been done months before by an appraiser where it had met a certain value. But this was the underwriter driving this. And the interesting part is then the lender called the listing agent and said, look, I've already burned all my bridges and I'm in trouble already. So if you could call all of your local appraisers that you know in this area and ask them if they will go out to that appraisal management company and pick up that order to do the field appraisal, okay? So the listing agent was in my training and she left when she got all these urgent calls, and she's so upset because she said, oh my God, my seller left, they're moved on, and now I have to tell them they're not going to close and we don't know when. I said, this is not acceptable. This delay is not acceptable. She called five appraisers in the area that she knew, and she said, would you please go out there and pick up that field appraisal request by this appraisal management company? They all turned her down. They said they won't work with that appraisal management company if they didn't trust it. They won't do any appraisals for it. Now, how do we know that? We don't know that. And she came back to me and she said, this is not going to work. The lender, is already in trouble because they contacted the current appraisal management company too many times asking them to get it done, which I don't think is out of line. I mean, if you are not going to get somebody to pick it up, what is the other recourse? That lender's going to then have to make a decision, right? Mm-hmm. And so the seller was beyond not understanding any of this, being told it did appraise, then being told it didn't appraise, and the parties have reached an agreement, and then now being told we can't go forward because we lowered this field appraisal and nobody wants to touch it. This just is the tip of the iceberg. When I was in the training earlier at the other office, the agents raised their hand. They said, "I didn't call you, but this happened to me Friday."
Yeah.
This happened, and it happened on last Thursday. Here's the problem. As I said, these lenders, for the very first time, are being hammered with potential fines for not doing certain things. If there's any type of activity or misinformation or wrong calculations or something that's not right, they have to stop the process and get it corrected. The appraisers are also being hammered on big time. Notify anybody if they talk to you about the value or if they put pressure on you, all of this. And so appraisers have been put a lot of pressure on. So you can see that this whole process, this whole loan process that's going to go forward as of October 3rd, it's not going to get better. And this isn't going to change, and this is not going to go away. So what we're going to have to do is really prepare the buyers and sellers for this process in light of these things happening. How on earth would we ever know that the underwriter would read the appraisal and challenge the comparable and stop something that had already been done by? We've never seen that, ever. So you just need to be aware of this. When I talked to you last month about if an appraiser contacts you, be very cordial with them. You can offer, as a listing agent, say, "Can I offer my comparables that I've used or my amenity list on my sellers?" If they say no, don't press it. You know what I'm saying? One time and offer it. If they don't accept it, don't challenge it, because you don't want the file to be red flagged and you be the reason that it stops. And it takes about 7 days for the review board to look at it. Yes?
Are you allowed to tell us what lender that underwriter is with?
I'll have to find out. I didn't ask. It's in the Hill Country. They're not local here. But I'll find out if it's got a branch office here. I do know. It's called Wells Fargo. That's right. I remember. I asked that question. I kept going, why do I? Because it wasn't a local lender. It was Wells Fargo. It was a bank. So again, just be very, I am concerned. As I said, this is something that we're going to see a lot more of. And that's not something that we can have a form that will help. Anything that we do, it won't help. That's not, because it's part of our control. And we need to let buyers and sellers know the potential for this. And one of the broker in the last one said to me, he said, "Harold, what can we do that we can help bypass all of this?" I said, "Well, probably the moment the listing agent knows the price of the property that was agreed upon in the contract, has some concerns regarding appraisal. The seller really needs to know that in writing. Well, if you accepted this offer and it is the best offer for you, I am concerned because my comps show the range of this and y'all settled on this sale price." In other words, the moment you're aware as a listing agent, you better put it right. Even if the seller accepted it, that's fine. But you don't want them coming back and saying, "Why did you tell me?" This could be a problem. And you can relate. Well, let me just explain the story that happened with one of the banks that sent out a field appraisal that wasn't picked up, but the underwriter actually didn't like the first appraisal when it met value, and they challenged it. What's interesting is they did challenge it because they felt the comparables for the subject property were too far away. The part about that is this was a property that had no comparables. It's in the middle of, the Hill Country. It's not like a development. So you probably won't have those issues when you have the type of housing that you might have where it's a residential development and there's several comps in there. This was a unique property because it had no comps. There was nothing to compare to. And the appraiser went out to properties that were as close to it that they could find. The interesting part is that this appraiser had access only to one MLS. And that MLS only had what they had in it, but there are two other MLSs in our area that gave different comparables. So again, it was this underwriter, it shows you that they are truly reading all this and evaluating these things. They're not letting it go. It's not going to be approved and then passed on. Each and every one of these files is going to come under extreme scrutiny. And so as you go through this process as of October 3rd, and now if you have a listing that you have right now that is not sold, and it has not sold by October 1st, you're going to take our agenda that we're using for the listing, and you're going to go and visit with your seller again and say, we're going to attach this to our listing agreement. I need to explain, since we didn't get your house under contract, this is what you're going to be faced with if a buyer presents an offer and there's financing. If it's cash, are you going to have this issue?
No.
So we're probably going to see sellers who would take a cash offer over a financed offer, and it might even be a significant reduction from the list price. You just don't know what's going to happen on that. I am going to tell you that we have a lot of cash transactions that don't close either. So there is no guarantee on any of this.
Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me. If you're driving a black Sequoia, you're parked in front of the dumpster. I won't tell you who you are. Just go ahead and stand up.
Okay.
Well, just so you know, you need to move because we're not supposed to block the dumpsters. Y'all did very well, by the way, where y'all parked that. Thank you for not blocking Dr. Hill's office or Blue Jay.
Yes.
Thank you so very much for parking on the street. But if you are driving that black Sequoia, play it off. Go to the ladies' room. I'm thinking it's a lady and maybe a male. But I'm moving my car, so there's going to be a spot right there in the back. Okay? Thank you so much.
Yes, okay. It takes a little while to get where you need the cards here. So what we're going to go through today are the new required forms. Nicole Joyce will be putting these forms in Dotloop. The minute she has placed them in Dotloop, she is going to send me an email showing me exactly where they are. I will forward that on to Veronica so Veronica can let you know exactly where they are. The time limits that we have is an Excel spreadsheet. That cannot be in Dotloop. Dotloop doesn't have the capabilities to do calculations with things. So it will be located in the Market Center intranet under documents in a folder called Risk Management. And it's the time limit. And you're going to need to use these time limits going forward big time, because you want to make sure that at all times your clients will say that you kept them aware of the time limits. You explained the time limits of the contracts. You didn't let any time go by between one performance and the other. That's the other thing I wanted to talk to you a little bit about. Trek is, they didn't approve any of these forms, and Trek really feels that it is your job as an agent, in particular a buyer agent, to make sure that there is no time limit in the contract or addendum that is not handled properly and timely. Okay? And we've had too many incidences where the buyer agent has failed to bring to the buyer's attention the number of days in third party, and that gets passed. Those number of days are no longer, able used by the buyer to say to the seller, I'm going to terminate because I either can get my terms or I'm not fine, I'm not approved individual. The problem is once those days pass in third party, it's over. There is no third party. There is no provision for a buyer to say to the seller, oh, I didn't get individually approved, now I get to terminate and get my earnest money back. That's the biggest problem. And one of the forms today, we have three forms for the buyer side. You can see how hard it's going to be for buyer agents because you're going to be in this constant mode of explaining and reviewing and monitoring. You're the project manager. You have to take care of all these things. How many of you have been project managers in past lives? Yeah, you're the driver. You're the one who's going to have to make sure no day goes by. If that's what your job is, to stay on top of that. provide them options and facilitate for them whatever they decide or want to approach as far as negotiation. If you don't do your job in that capacity, you are going to come under scrutiny. We have several agents whose buyers come back to us and say, the agent never told me before those days passed that I would lose my earnest money. So I created a form that you're going to use that actually says that for you, because our contract doesn't say it. And I'm so worried that you're not going to use the same words I would use, which are real clear. You are going to lose your earnest money, you know? You can be diplomatic at sometimes, but you know, sometimes you just have to be direct. Because when you have said, don't worry, I'll take care of that, so many times in the transaction, they're thinking, she's going to take care of it. I'm always going to be all right. They're not thinking that there are provisions that they might be subject to in the contract, okay? And I know you do that because y'all are caretakers. You have a big, big heart. You're used to handling a lot of bad things. Say, oh, we can work through this. We'll give this. We'll do this. And so what happens is the buyers kind of sit back and think, well, the agent's doing all the work. I'll let them take all the risk. And so today I'm going to kind of show you why I want you to transfer the risk you've been taking on that legitimately belongs in the buyer's position, not in the buyer agent. So, what we're going to do is, first thing we're going to look at is there's only one form for a seller for the CFPB. So, we're going to go through that one first because that's the easiest one. That's the listing one. And at the very top of the page, it says attached main part of the listing agreement for property and the amount of it on the property address. There are no fill in the blanks on this other than people signing it, acknowledging it, dating it, or putting in the address. And that's because this will now be made a part of your written listing agreement. The reason we did this is we can't do this is our agreements are all private. They are not promulgated by FRED. They're provided by our association. So we don't have to worry. I would never try and think that I could write an addendum for a promulgated form. I can't do that because I'm not an attorney. You can't either because you're not an attorney. And so but our private forms are for that reason. Our association created them so that they would help protect the brokers and agents' interests, which is the exact opposite of our contract forms that TREC provide, correct? TREC is protecting who? The consumer. TAR says I'm protecting my association members. So they gave us a listing agreement because we took a code of ethics. We said that everything that we do for others, like our clients, will be reduced in right. Because your code of ethics, that's why the broker has certain forms that are a requirement, because they know that that is part of your duty. You are required to put it in writing. How you work in behalf of another, how long it goes on, and who gets paid, and how you get paid. You know what I'm saying? There are things we just know we cover in writing. So on the listing agreement, we're going to add this. It gave the website, and I thought this is a good way for a seller to go out and now understand that everything you said about it is always favoring the consumer. They're going to know about that website big time. And on that website, it's got a lot of information, but it's all about the consumer. If the consumer doesn't get this, then they can complain here. If the consumer is not treated this way. So it's very much pro-consumer and an advocate of making sure that the consumer understands this process better. That's if the consumers will read, but you know, we don't know. We know a seller most likely will go out there because it affects them so greatly. And it's not in their control, you know what I'm saying? So that's probably why sellers will do it. It talks about the 3-day waiting period. That's the first time the seller is going to say, what? And you're going to say, here's what's going to happen. If you accept an offer and there is a loan on the offer, that by law, by federal law, not Texas law and not Keller Williams, may have been quoted, or there was a mistake on these calculations for prorations or something, the lender will then have to say, by federal law, this process has to start over. And the seller has to understand that they can say, they cannot say no to it. A seller now in paragraph 9 says that if the buyer hasn't closed on that day, they have options. But if a buyer comes to a seller prior to closing day and says, it is mandated by federal law that we start the 3-day waiting period over, a seller can't say, no, I won't extend the contract. And a seller can't say, and I want money to extend the contract. They can't do that. It's totally stripped from them by federal law. And my problem is if I didn't reach enough listing agents with that, they will give their sellers misinformation about that. Trek put in some promulgated language that they didn't approve, but basically I took what they're offering as something they're probably going to approve in November, and I placed it on these addendum as a guide to make sure the parties understood that this is what's going to happen. The sellers are not going to be too happy about it. That's why the seller needs to know at the time of the listing that this is what's going to face them, no matter what. We'd all love to have a cash world where they were going to get cash offers, but that's not the reality. So you want them to be prepared for what's coming. And this addendum will help start that. You also, as a listing agent, will have a big process once you get the offers, but we'll talk about that in the time limits. But again, you have to understand that seller can never say, I'm not going to extend it for the 3-day waiting period. That's federal law. And that's what they'll read when they go to that website. The paragraph in the middle, after the terminology that is being used, says this change could have an impact on the timely performance by all parties in the transaction. One of the considerations could be the timeliness of completing any and all agreed upon repairs agreements. You know, the buyer and seller can negotiate at time of offer. In paragraph 7D2, they can say, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, if you do the following repairs or replacements or whatever, then I'll go forward with this offer. So there could be something that's there from the time the contract is executed, or it could be an amendment that the parties reach during a termination option period. Okay? But no matter what, the seller has to know that per the contract, the seller is obligated to provide paid receipts proving the completion of the work. The paid receipts of all completed work will probably need to be provided within 15 days of closing. So I provided on our time limits 15 days before closing, and it says all repairs should be completed and receipts should be given at that time. And this is a recommendation that has been advised to Keller Williams Realty for various creditors so that sellers are not the cause of the delay for closing. See, that's, yes?
So the 15 days, is that the federal law or is that our policy?
That is what we have advised them to do. It says it right there. It says this is a recommendation that has been advised to Keller Williams, and that is exactly right. I took the big top lenders that do most of the production, and they all agreed that if the seller cannot prove that the repairs have been completed and paid for, that it will delay the process. See, everything has to be tied up in a little bow prior to that 3-day waiting period beginning, and then they can close on that 4th day. So if the seller was thinking they could wait till later to do a lot of this, it could cause the delay, and it would be the seller's fault in that respect, not the buyer's. Everybody understand the difference?
I have a point. Does it say that they have, is it just in our time limit, we're saying 15 days?
Yes, we're showing a recommended 15 days. The parties can choose to do otherwise if they want to be foolish and maybe cause the delay. But a seller has to truly understand this new process has pushed everything up dramatically. It's going to affect you big time because your DAs have to be to the title company well before you ever do it now, or you won't be on there. So, you know, there's a lot of issues that affect you too as far as making sure you got things to the title company. But a seller has to understand that this could be a situation where maybe a seller will choose not to make some repairs, but rather discuss a concession that would be given for the buyer's closing costs, or maybe it will be a reduction in the sales price. It just depends upon the type of repairs. If there's a foundation issue or a roof issue, good luck on that one. No lender is going to approve the loan if there's an issue about something that could be hazardous. A lender required repair, that type of thing. But I'm talking about some repairs that y'all get involved in when I read the amendments and I go, oh gosh, I hope they really handle this well, because there were a lot of little things on there, and some of y'all attached lists with initials, which is very detailed and very good, but that's a lot of work on your part. You're going to have to be aware that, hey, the seller can't say, well, I want to find out if they're going to really be serious about this, and they usually run away. We have some sellers who don't do it the last week of closing. And then they get in trouble because guess what? The roofers are all backed up because of all the previous work. No repair should ever be after the day of closing. Okay? I just want you to understand that. Everything needs to be done. Here's what happens when buyers and sellers negotiate a roof to be put on, even if money is escrowed, a roof to be put on after closing and funding. Here's what happens. The buyer and seller decided that, you know, the buyer wanted the seller to find out if there needs a new roof because the inspector, the truck inspector said it needed a new roof, okay? So the sellers called their insurance company up. The insurance company adjuster came out and confirmed it was shocked. It was a horrible roof and it needed to be replaced, including the decking, okay? So they reached upon a settlement. The buyer agent was so good, they wrote this beautiful little amendment, and in the amendment they wrote that if there is a repair or replacement for rotted or repair wood for the fascia and trim, that the seller would make up the difference. Okay, it would come out of the seller's pocket if it wasn't covered under the insurance claim. Here's the problem. They escrowed money in closing, right? Seller signed a contract with the roofing company to put that roof on after closed and fund. The roofing company came out to the property, removed the shingles and the decking, and oh no, they found that the bracing was inadequate and it could never support a roof. Well, the buyer and the buyer agent thought with that amendment, the seller will have to pay. That's that money we escrowed. The seller will have to pay the difference. Unfortunately, she was very exact, and she said to repair rotted wood on fascia and trim. She didn't say anything about bracing. Now, here's what would have happened if the buyer said, I'm not paying for it, I'm going after the seller. He doesn't have a leg to stand on. Who do you think he's going to come after?
The agent.
Why would that agent know about bracing when the own insurance company adjuster did it? I think it's the insurance company's fault. They need to have a little come to Jesus meeting with a former seller. You know what I'm saying? Because I don't know about you, but when they review it, they just don't look at it outside. They go in the attic and they check all of the framing, making sure there is support because the roof was in such bad shape. So now we're in a problem where the amendment wasn't good. It was very specific what the seller would pay when the insurance companies did. If she just left it, that any expenses would have, you know, rather than tying it down to this wood and fascia, because they saw all that wood rot and they knew that. And that wasn't covered under the claim. Okay? That was called deferred maintenance. That's a nice word. Nice words for it. That's probably true. So what happened on this is that the buyer is now $7,500 for the new bracing. But the buyer keeps saying, but they couldn't have put the roof on. And I went, yes, and that was your problem. You allowed it to be done after closing. Nothing has happened. You know what I'm saying? Because you as the agent are going to be the one in trouble. Because no matter what magic words you put on the amendment, it's not going to be right. You know, it's going to be some situation we're not going to cover. So even though the party wanted to do this and they thought this was a great idea, you're going to always have in writing to them, this is a horrible idea. What if they take this off and find mold in the house? Now you
You know what I'm saying? If we knew what it is and we didn't say something and we forecasted in the future, that would be much better. But we get into big trouble when we try and imagine what it's going to be like in the future. We really work better when we deal with something that is now and an issue that has been identified and we know the extent of it.
So can we extend the leave and close it?
That would have been the, she said, so we could be delayed. That would have been the only option is to delay the closing. And that was at the buyer. The lender felt comfortable with this because USAA had already provided the proceeds. They had signed the contract with the roofing company and they had deposited in escrow at the title $10,000 for 90 days. That was well a good amount over what the insurance claim had already been taken care of. So it, from the surface of all of this, it looked like everything was just wonderful. It was just the amendment was so narrow and a judge would easily see that, and a jury would easily see that bracing was not trim or fascia. That's the problem. Again, just be aware of the issue that we recommend to sellers, that they were going to have to expedite if they agreed to do any repairs or replacements. Because if they don't provide the paid receipts, do we believe that they did that? No. Furthermore, the underwriter won't believe them. The underwriter doesn't care. They don't put a face to the seller. They just want proof that this borrower that they're giving this loan to won't have a mechanic's lien the next 60 days because the seller didn't pay the bill for the HVAC or the pool repair. You see what I'm saying? So it's nothing new. It has always been there. You're just going to see it used a lot more because lenders are going to be a lot more precise and careful in light of all of these issues that are coming up. You're just going to see a lot of things that we didn't see in the past. And again, that's because they know that they're heavily regulated now, and fines are very punitive, and the lenders are afraid, big time. The next thing the seller would have to know, really, is the process. I talk about how the closing disclosures will be drafted. At what point, once everybody's finished everything that they need, they'll bring all the parties and say, please provide me all your information that needs to be on the HUD-1. And that, many times, is the information that's in our contract about maybe who's going to pay for the survey, who's going to pay what fees from a mandatory property owners association, any closing costs the seller is going to give to a buyer, any kind of residential service contract. So there are all those monies that the parties agreed to that we as agents know need to be on the HUD-1 in the right place and who's paying it and who's getting credit for. So that process will happen once that is complete by all the parties. Then the lender will finalize the closing disclosures, and then they will submit them to the buyer to begin the 3-day waiting period. That 3-day waiting period has got to be acknowledged for it to begin. And so we have some lenders who said, we're going to send them out by email. And the moment they acknowledge in the software that they've received it, then we will start the first day of the 3-day waiting period. Some lenders have said, no, I'm going to personally deliver it to them. Okay? So they're going to personally deliver it and get them to sign off so that we all know this is the first day of the 3-day waiting period. There are some lenders that said, no, we're mailing it. And that means that 7 days prior to closing, everything's got to be tied up in a bow. That's why the repairs really are pushed the way they are, because we don't know the method of delivery except at the time of offer, then we should know how that lender will deliver them. But if for any reason we let the seller know that if for any reason the closing disclosure or the final loan estimate changes, the waiting period will start over and we'll delay the closing and consummation date. The buyer may extend the closing up to 10 days. That is from the TREC recommended promulgated language in paragraph 9. If the creditor provides notice to the buyer and escrow officer, and if the buyer then provides an amendment to you for extending the closing consummation date, the burden is on the buyer. Here we have this closing date right here, and we are in the second day of the 3-day waiting period. The buyer has to get that amendment members of the seller prior to the closing date. They can't let the closing date pass. They would be in default of the contract, okay? And so their time is very critical to make sure you're available, they're available, you can get all of this expedited and done. And I'm gonna tell you that my recommendations, and this is what the seller needs to know, and you're gonna be dealing as a listing agent with agents from other companies. You don't know what they're gonna tell the buyer, you don't know the process, you don't know what they've explained to the buyer and how they handle it. But you as a listing agent, while you can't share these documents for the buyer agent with another company, you'll have measures, your little sheet that you can contact the lender and ask these questions. Yes, cheat sheet. Basically, it's gonna give you things you need to know so you can tell your seller about this offer. And one of the things that we recommend when we work with a buyer is that we're gonna ask the buyer to take a day of vacation, a part of a day, on the first day of the 3-day waiting period. And the reason I came up with that is because if we leave that buyer off on their own to review those documents and acknowledge it, we could be at 11:59 on the 3rd day, and y'all would like to probably be asleep, right? Yeah. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna make this process better, because we're going to tell them, invite your lender, you can use my conference room, I can help you answer any questions about the truth and lending part of the closing disclosures, but I certainly can address anything about all the contract documents that we have. But that lender is invited, most of the lenders have said that's a great idea, I think it's wonderful because I can deliver it to them right then. We're not gonna get a copy of them ahead of time unless you wanna take on that liability personally, getting all the truth and lending and all those type things. But they'll be there together, and you'll be able to review that part that affects you, which is like the old HUD-1. You won't ever be able to answer any questions about truth and lending. That's not your thing. That's the loan officers. So again, providing the place for them to come do it, you're going to have confidence that the first day of the 3-day waiting period, you know now if it's okay and everybody's gone forth or there was an issue. And I think that's a good thing to let sellers know. This is how you recommend this process, and now you need to find out how the other side plans on handling it, because I think that will be important for your seller to know that as well. Again, there's only one document for the listing side, and really, sellers have a lot invested in this process, but not the amount of work you're going to have to do as a buyer's agent. A listing agent won't have to do as much. Other than making sure
that they
inform the seller
of their expectations. Yes. Before we do that, I mean, if I'm the buyer and I request 10 additional days, is that at no charge? Mm-hmm. We can't charge you.
That you cannot. It's federal law. Any extension that is mandated by federal law requirements, the seller can't say no, and they cannot ask for money. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Of
second day. But there are never, we never count Sundays or legal holidays, federal legal holidays. And I think most of the holidays that lenders and title companies take, even in the state of Texas, that there are extra ones, that won't count. But right now it says federal holidays. So what happens is the first day is on Friday, the second day is Saturday, when is the third day?
Monday.
So they could never close until Tuesday or later. So you have to understand that while the time limits can calculate a formula, it cannot add because it's a Sunday or a holiday. It doesn't know that. It's not that smart. But you are. And you're going to be able to manually adjust that day to reflect if you need to add a day for a Sunday or a day for a holiday. So I'll let you see in the time limits where you are personally going to have to make sure and count and maybe add a day to the performance on that. Again, it explains to the buyer about the three-day waiting period. And then talks about the terminology the same way. Talks about the process that we did with the sellers. And on paragraph three, it says, if for any reason the closing disclosure of the final loan estimate changes, the waiting period will start over on the delayed consummation date. And it says, if there is a delay, the creditor will provide notice to you and the escrow officer. And then you must immediately provide an amendment to contract extending the closing date for an amount up to 10 days. Failure to do this will result in default of the contract. I wanted the buyer to see that this is important for them. They have to do it prior to the closing date passage, and they're going to be notified, and maybe you won't be. It is that the buyer will be notified along with the escrow officer. They don't say anything about the agent, okay? So your buyer has to be able to get that notification, pay attention to it right away, and pass it on to you so that you're aware that an amendment might need to be done immediately so that you can extend the closing date.
Yes.
And now it's until 5 p.m., right?
Yeah. Do a much better job as a listing agent, maybe closing disclosures on the first day of the three-day waiting period, preferably at the lender's office. Well, that's if they use a lender that is available, open. Most of the lenders that we have say, well, your office is perfect, just have to come here, they know where you are. Even though the lenders may have.
I apologize, but if any of you are parked in the front, directly in front of the dental office, any of those spots there, if you could move your vehicle, they've actually called us and told us that they have no room there for their clients. So if you're parked there anywhere in front, please move your vehicle. Appreciate it.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
And again, as I said, the lender that I talked to this several months ago, they said this is a great idea to do this. And my thought was, I'm not saying that I don't trust the buyer to do it on their own. I'm just afraid because we're not going to be a part of, you know, directing that part. It's really going to be so much from the lender standpoint. We're not going to be aware, and we would love to pass on to the listing agent. The buyer has reviewed all the documents, everything's been approved, we're going to be able to close at the end of the three-day waiting period. You know, I'm seeing that's a positive for you to be able to maintain that communication. My concern also was, what if on the last day of the three-day waiting period, they found out that there's a fluctuation in the rate or term that they didn't see earlier because they were procrastinating reviewing it? And as I said, you can't go through these documents. You're not going to be any help. You could hold them maybe and flip the pages for them. But you know what I'm saying? You're not going to be able to address anything. They're not our documents. And that's where I wanted the lender to kind of know that we're not just sitting over here. We are proactive. We are agents that are going to get this transaction closed, and we're going to do it with good methodology and good business practices. And your buyers are going to appreciate that. It's the same way when a buyer says, I'm not going to go to the inspection. I'm thinking, well, how stupid is that? It's your inspection. Why wouldn't you go? Why should I go to your inspection? If you're not going to go to your inspection. You know what I'm saying? They think if they make you go, then you're going to be responsible for everything. That's where they're transferring their own personal risk onto you. And that's not what we want. We want you to transfer it back where it belongs. It's their contract. They're going to live in this house and love it or else. Right? So we're going to say, you're going to love this house or else. Now, the thing that we'll attach to the buyer-tenant agreement, and they're going to not pay attention to it until we get down to the nitty-gritty of it. The next form I want to go through is the CFPB worksheet prior to offer. Now here's how a prudent agent will act from October 3rd. And you know why I say that? Because Craig says you're supposed to be a prudent agent. That means you're always going to err on the side of doing the wisdom and the right thing for your client. That's what they mean by that. And it's not a derogatory term at all. It's that we're going to always err on the side of being cautious and benefit of our client. So here's what happens. You meet a buyer, maybe an opportunity call. They're all excited. They like the way you sound on the phone. They come into the office to meet you because you're going to do your presentation. You're going to say, look, disregard everything you read on all the blog sites and all the social media. October 3rd brought us a new process for our contract and your loan. And let me just explain this to you. Now, if they've even acquired their own lender ahead of this, no matter what you say to them, it's going to be different than what the lender has already communicated. But this is the form that you're going to give them almost immediately after the information about brokerage services. Okay? And the reason is this is this cheat sheet that I'm talking about that listing agents can use in the process of helping their seller evaluate if they want to accept this offer from this buyer. The buyer needs to be told, look, I'm giving you the sheet of questions that have to be answered by your lender because you need this information to put an offer into your seller. I could come up with the best time frames. I could fill in all the blanks. And if the lender doesn't agree with them, it won't matter. You can come up with all the time frames. And if the lender doesn't agree, go after your agent and give them money for their earnest money. They should have done that. They didn't do their job. We had one lender that made a mistake, and they still said to go after the buyer agent. I said, really? I said, I want an email this afternoon to your buyer saying, really? The lender was responsible for that, and you need to go after your lender for the earnest money. I said, you CC me on it, don't blind card and copy, you put my risk management up there, and you let your buyer know that you have notified your risk manager. That lender would never get any more business in any office that I had in the voice. There's a reason. Don't be sixing anybody on you and saying it's your fault. You need to pay for it. That's ridiculous. So, again, these are questions that your buyer needs to give to the lender, get the answers, give them back to you. And this needs to be done ASAP. That's part of that deciding about the lender and committing to them. Because the lender is going to have to fill this in and give you the detail, Mr. and Mrs. Buyer. Number one, have you received all the information on the consumer's, buyer's assets and income and reviewed credit report application? Yes or no? And will that information be included in your conditional qualification letter? Well, the nice part is we know it is required by law, so we're kind of giving them the benefit of the doubt and think that we don't know what we're talking about. So, hopefully it will say yes, because that is what they're required to do. You don't want any lender to send you, if you were a listing agent, and you got an offer and the lender's letter didn't cover that, you're going to now know that that letter is not valid. Okay, you need to know these terms for your seller. Number two. How many calendar days will you need to provide individual approval? This goes directly back to the number of days we're going to ask the seller for time to get you individually approved by the lender or give you a provision to terminate and walk away and get your earnest money back. Okay? So they have to tell you. The lenders that I've talked to said that if your buyer does all of this ahead of time, I'm going to be able to give you probably a really good indication if they're individually approved in about 9 days. That was pretty good. So that's the kind of thing you're trying to accomplish here, is to get the time frame established so that your buyer knows and has a pretty good idea what they need to negotiate with the seller. It says number three, provide the date that you'll be able to close this transaction. Well, most of our lenders are saying 45 days. We have one lender who is stating they will close in 30 days if the buyers do this. And that's pretty bold, because that's a hard thing to go out there and say that, but you know, they have a really good track record so far, and they hired the attorney who represented the Consumer Protection Financial Bureau. So I guess they know what they're doing. You know, they've kind of got all the ducks in a row, and they've been working on this for a while. The next says, can the buyer receive a contribution for closing costs from the seller? Well, that's very practical, isn't it?
Right. Yeah.
And it says, the next question is the one you don't ask. If yes, what is the maximum amount that the buyer will have for closing costs? Not what they can get from the seller, but what closing costs do they actually have? If they've only got $1,200 in closing costs, they can't ask the seller for more. Because that's seller money, anything over that. And too many times on weekends, you negotiate a dollar amount in lieu of repairs. And the buyer looks at, oh, I'm going to get $4,000 from the seller, this will be good. And the buyer doesn't realize they don't have $4,000 in closing costs, but you should. And you don't know that because the lender won't return your call. Again, getting it all up ahead of time is much better for you to work under the time constraints that we sometimes are faced. The next one says, what are your adjusted origination charges? Years ago, it was called a loan origination fee. And it usually was a percent, okay? Usually 1%. Well, that's not the case anymore. Most of them work off of a gradual scale that says anything from 0 to $75,000, it'll be $1,200. $75,000 to $150,000, it'll be $2,900. So in other words, instead of telling us what the percentage was, which is what our forms require, they're going to give you a dollar amount, okay? And in that dollar amount, then, because Fred told me you were mathematically proficient, you will convert that to a percentage. a temporary residential lease on this contract. We need to know that at time of offer, because in light of all these changes, most sellers are gonna put one on at time of offer. They're not gonna wait until later down the line when this buyer will say, no, I'm not gonna give it to you. They're gonna do when they have a position of power before they say yes. It's on contract. And so what happens on that is many types of financing prohibit the borrower from allowing the seller to stay in the property for extended periods of time. So you don't want your buyer to find out that they have to be in the property at the first of the next month, and they've given a 45-day seller's temporary lease. It won't work. The underwriter's gonna make that sucker come right off of that, and then the whole world's gonna cave in, because your buyers and sellers have already negotiated and planned for that, and it's not gonna work. It probably could work in a default basis, where the seller now, the provisions have changed, and the seller could probably say, I can't remove it, we'll have to terminate the contract. Okay, again, when your buyer hasn't done the right things, the seller has made a decision based on what you gave them. And if you told them it was okay for 45 days, they can go to the bank on that. You as a buyer will be in trouble. Okay, so you have to understand, anything the buyer conveys to the seller's relying upon that to be truthful. And they're gonna only make a decision based on what they've been presented. And if your buyer didn't give something truthfully to them, it doesn't sound like they have a meeting of the minds, does it? And there won't be a contract. So it could cause major problems. The next one says, when will you order the appraisal? Now, I've been told by our lenders that the minute you have an executed contract, they should give it to the lender. They will order the appraisal. They'll put it in a queue. They won't probably have the appraiser go out until they make sure that the buyer is going to go forward with the contract. In other words, they're going to waive under their option period and go forward. But again, we've been told that they're going to order right away. If you're working with lenders that are not part of our lender network that are aligned with Keller Williams, you will want to always know this answer, because that's important. The buyer needs to know that, because they don't want the buyer to think that this is not an important component to make sure everything goes timely, so that we can get everything tied up, the appraisal back, and if out of underwriting and everything is good to close. The next one says, if the consumer buyer chooses to lock the rate, please provide me written notice and the date of lock expiration and the following email address. Most of the time, the borrower and the lender have had these conversations, and you're not a part of it. You don't know. And if they don't tell you, you fail to ask, then there could be problems if you've allowed the buyer and seller to negotiate an extension of the closing date, and then the buyer finds out, oh, they've lost $3,500 and the rate expired, that type of thing. So again, it's important, and you want that lender to notify you by your email address, because most of the time the borrower doesn't know what we're talking about. You know what I'm saying? They just are not real familiar with this process and these terms. But you are, and you never want them to lose their locked rate. That's significant financial consideration for them. The next one says, if a non-royalty item addendum is a consideration on this offer, we can have a problem with this being a part of the contract. Here's what most of the lenders told me, even our in-house lenders and our friends. They said, I don't ever want to see a non-royalty item addendum. That's the truth. That's how they feel. Part of it is because if there's any value to it, the appraisers are required to meet value. And appraisers are not going to be happy campers if they see refrigerator, washer and dryer, $1,500, whatever. They're just kind of like they're going to implode. Okay. So far, we haven't had too many problems where there is no value assessed on it, and the appraiser doesn't have to go that extra step. But if the appraiser sees that there's a value, this could be problems for the appraisal. Okay, so you need to know up front from the lender, will there be a problem with a non-realty item addendum? And if the lender says no, then you're going to say, so if they negotiate a value, will that cause a problem? Let them tell you the rest of those stories on that, because that's really what you need to find out. And then the good part is, much to the lender and then go back to the buyer. The buyer is thinking, you're the reason I can't have any more loans yet. And so the problem is, we don't do anything once the lender has ruled and said there can be no non-LGI. In other words, we have to cease. We don't have a form that will help these buyers and sellers convey that refrigerator and washer and dryer. We can't be a part of it. We could be practicing fraud if we were aware of something and we have not disclosed it to the lender. And why on earth, if the lender said no, you're trying to hide something from them? No, that would not be good for you. You cannot do that. You can never conceal any amendments to the contract. I have a lot of agents who think we won't submit this one to the lender. Well, that's committing fraud, and I don't want to visit you in an orange jumpsuit. The last place I was at training this morning, the broker and the team leader, he came and he says, excuse me, I have to interrupt. I asked him, he had this orange bundle, you know, it was a prison jumpsuit. And he said, this is what she tries to keep all of you out of. He was having a fun on a Monday morning on that part. But he really did want you to understand that when they say no, you really don't get to say, well, let me figure out how to do this. We don't have a bill of sale. We don't have those forms. So we don't make up forms. Your broker can provide you a form, and we're using it on non-promulgated forms. But you can't make up a bill of sale for your clients. That's not possible. They'd have to find some other source, and you don't want to know what they're doing because the moment you know, you have to tag along. And they have to know that. The other thing I wish you would tell your clients to work this thing kind of in your presentation, saying that at any time, any material information I have about the transaction of the property, I have to disclose and I have to be truthful. You know what I'm saying? We have a lot of sellers who like to whisper and say, oh, I didn't pay for the roof repair. In fact, I went to Vegas. Now, I did have that client. Did any of y'all have that client? He was divorced and he was upset because he lost so much in the divorce, and then he had a roof damage and then it was a total loss on the roof. And I asked him, had he ever had, see, I went through the seller's disclosure, I know it by heart. I said, have you ever made a claim? Oh yeah, I have. I got money for a new roof. I said, well, when did you put the new roof on? Oh, I didn't do that. I went to Vegas. You know, I was going through this really bad divorce. And he said, I went to Vegas. I said, well, you don't have to tell them you went to Vegas, but you are going to have to tell them you used all the proceeds and not to replace the roof. What do you think was the first thing the buyers negotiated? A new roof, and he had to put well. And I told him, he says, no, we don't have to tell them, and I'm thinking, this is not going to work for me. And the worst part, this was the first time I'd ever done a sale. We had a distressed seller. He had lots of equity in the home, but it hadn't been paying his mortgage. Oh. And there was a company called Countrywide. I stayed on the line within 13 hours during that transaction. One time for 5 hours before they came back.
Wow.
So, you know, I remember how it used to be in the old days about, and this wasn't a short sale. This was the seller had tons of equity. He was going to lose all his equity if we didn't sell this home in 3 weeks. Plus, he took all the money, went to Vegas, and didn't replace the roof. And did I say that we had to have the foundation repaired? Oh, of course. We had to do the roof and the foundation. Oh, it was delightful. That's probably why I do the job I do, because my transactions were never easy. And I handled transactions. Attorneys will refer me to very bad situations. Divorce, foreclosure, death, the bickering between the heirs when we have 13 heirs, and five ex-wives. And I'm not making that up. He had children with every set of family except this fifth one. And he died on us. It was delightful. We had three wills, different wives with different children. You know, they decided, hey, let's do a new will. I don't know what that's about. Bless his heart, he's in heaven somewhere. And the other thing we had to do is we had to have an auction to sell everything off. He had antique cars and a garage that was built as a builder, and he had an antique. It was amazing. That transaction in itself was enough to teach you for a lifetime about people. And so, you know, I had to go before the judge and all these other types of things and swear that I wasn't, you know, lying. Nobody would make this up. So, again, I have a lot of familiarity with really difficult, strange contracts and conditions of that. So, anyway, if I can get through them, you can. The next one says, if the property does not appraise for the sales price, will you decline property approval for paragraph 4 of the contract? That's real important. I'm going to tell you why. Most of the time, we have this situation where the buyer is putting 20% or more down on a conventional lot. We never have it under FHA or VA because they don't ever have to buy a property that doesn't appraise. It's in our contract big time, okay? It's a federal law. So what's interesting about this is that the lenders don't know our contracts either. And so a lot of lenders, if they're out of Texas, they don't know them at all. So you have to ask this question because you need to know, in the event that this buyer put 50% down or 30% down, the buyer needs to know you need to get it appraised during your option period because your lender is not going to give you an out to be able to terminate the contract and get your honest like that. And they have to know it. They're like cash buyers. Okay. And so that's one of those serious situations. Most of the lenders that we deal with that have this scenario, these are very strong buyers. They have assets. They have everything. The lender said, I can get that appraised in 2 days. You know what I'm saying? They're really good borrowers. So they get things expedited when there's that situation. But most of the lenders, if they're not local Texas lenders, they will not know about our contract. And that provision is only for the lender. It doesn't say that the buyer gets to terminate. It says if the lender doesn't approve the property, okay? And if that lender says, oh, no, I'll approve the property. I don't care if it appraises or not. He's got plenty of money. Then you know you have to do something differently for a buyer. The next one says, if the consumer buyer chooses to lock in the rate, please provide me written notice of the date of lot expiration at the following email address. Well, we don't know that, and I want you to be sent the email that says there is a lock, and when it doesn't expire, because you're going to need to know that if the buyer and seller have to negotiate closing date or moving up to closing date. The next one says, please provide the email address and phone number for contacting you on weekends. You're available all the time. Why shouldn't they be? Right. I'm sorry, my lender, God love him, he would return my phone call anytime he got if he was away. And because he knew that I only called when I needed his help or I had a buyer who needed a situation. And that's the kind of lender that, you know, always comes through for you. If there's a four-letter word in the lending institution called bank, they probably won't be as responsive on this unless they are a team that the bank acquired and that team has come in and worked inside the bank, but they really are a functioning team that has their own standards of production. You know what I'm saying? Wells Fargo and a lot of banks have done that over the years. They have got smart. They've gone out and found these real good lender teams. And just like Keller Williams did, and they let them come into their banking operation and perform their lending function within the confines of the bank. But if they're really, you know, they're on their own, they're independent contractors, basically. The last one says, please provide the delivery method for the closing disclosures to the consumer buyer. Email, mail, personal delivery. And the reason we need to know that is because that puts the time element for when the first day of the 3-day waiting period will begin. If it's by mail, it's 7 days. If it's by email, it should be kind of the first day. So it's kind of giving you a range for your time limits to know what is the possibility for the time limits regarding this 3-day waiting period. If the lender is going to mail it out, instead of it going 4 days before closing, it's going to go 7 days before closing. So you can see how we have to get everything kind of tied up in a nice little bow and everything done well. Otherwise, that lender won't be able to mail it out in a timely fashion so that we can close by the closing day. Now again, this is really the buyer's responsibility. Mr. and Mrs. Buyer, I'm glad you made a commitment to XYZ lender. You need to get with them today and start getting these answers, because we need these answers for you to present an offer to the seller. And I know today I'm going to find a home that you want, so you need to do this now. You see that urgency? They need to be told they need to do it right away, okay? So that's going to be the biggest thing that you're going to have to do, is get this buyer to do it right away, rather than holding on to this form. And when they want to present an offer, say, oh, go get all these answers from your lender. Well, let's put your lender on the phone and get these answers. You're going to have to be better about the timing of that, because you really need all of that ahead of time. Now, the next thing we're going to do is go through the buyer's checklist.
They're not doing that now. They are naming you if you cannot prove to them in writing.
they do that. I know, because we got the complaint and the agent said, oh, Marilyn, they told us to do that. I said, well, let's use common sense here. I don't think any seller is going to be not too thrilled that you called them at 6:30 in the morning while they're trying to either get ready to go out the door for work, because they have to leave 14 hours earlier because they live in Houston. You know? And that's why I left Houston and swore I would never go back here and live, because I lived in Sprite over on the wet at Stupner Airline. And I had a 3-hour commute a day to downtown Houston. This is before the HOV. So, you know, when I left, I said, I'm never going to be. I have tax on my car. I go on every toll road. I spend probably $100 a month on tolls. But I saved time while I was in Katy just a few minutes before I got here. Tomorrow I'll be in Woodlands in the morning and then be in Pearland at once. That's not easy. No, Woodlands takes me 2 hours to get there in the morning. So again, what you're going to need to pay attention to is communication to your clients on a regular basis. Don't call them at non-business hours, okay, please, because we have had a lot of complaints on that. And again, when you communicate to your sellers, and it's really hard. My team was, every Monday, they had to pick up the phone and talk to their sellers and then follow it up and send the status report in writing. And the first thing they had to say, I tell them, you have to know that seller, what they know. I did not sell your house last week. And the first thing out of their mouth, and that's what I thought I would do. Then when they did their status report at the very top, it says, I did not sell your house last week, but I did the following things to market the property. I made every one of the agents contact 25 new agents that they had never met and had never talked about this listing to, and enter a conversation and bring it to their attention. Were able to document that. So every seller knew we were not just sitting back there hoping the other broker would do their job. We were out there marketing what we had to do. But again, every Monday morning, and I loved it because they were such sweet people on my team, and I would be sitting there and everybody would think, you know how you're in a small room, you can have a lot of room, and my one partner, she's the one who is like a siren. She can give the worst information, but people love her because she is this hypnotic siren type voice. And I could hear her. So she's getting around to the part where she didn't sell the house last week. But she was going to get it all softened up real good so that that seller wasn't even going to care
if she didn't sell it.
And the other agent would be, well, you know how Marilyn is. I have to tell you, I didn't sell your house last week, and she's sitting right next to me, and she knows that I have to say that to you. But we did the following things, and then followed it up. Right. I think that's the hardest thing for us as sales position to kind of be negative, because it is, I didn't sell your house last week. But then you say, but I did the following things. And if you didn't do anything, it's hard for you to write, I did nothing in that spot. And that's why I created that form for my team to use, because they couldn't write, I did nothing in that spot, because I would see them. And I held myself to the same standard. They had to look at what I did and what I didn't do. So again, it was nothing that I wouldn't expect of myself. It's just we need to stay in touch with them. When you do these expires and other things, please do not call them at, you know, at times that could cause an issue for them, because we have had quite a few complaints, and that's how we found out that they've always said, you know, get them when they're brushing their teeth. So again, I just want you to be mindful of those things. Now, the buyer's checklist is a document that here's how this is going to work. You're going to go through this with the buyer the minute you have an executed contract, because you just ran the time limits based off of your executed contract. So you have the time limits in place, and then you're going to have this checklist. And you're going to be real positive right now. You're going to be able to meet with them, cross some things off, say, we've already done some of these things. Let's go through this so that you know what you have to do next time. It's a very positive, but it's a dynamic document. And what I mean by that, it's ever-changing. In .lib, you're going to be able to have them send it back your way saying, here's the updated on the new time limits, I finished this. Then you're going to go back to them and say, well, we're taking care of this and this. So it's going to be a document that you're going to be using
Now, prior to contract, select lender, creditor, and provide all the required documentation for loan approval.
Well, that's pretty simple, and it's like the buyer will be able to say, I've done that, done that, done that. Very good positive affirmation, and they'll be able to get through this a little bit easier. The next one says, set up a weekly schedule and consult with the lender, creditor, and review your status. If the lender won't do that for your borrower, that's pretty sad. That's not a lender they want. But it's on them. I want them to set the appointment up, talk to the lender, then tell you what was discussed. In other words, they have to report back to you because they're the ones visiting with the lender. When you visit with the lender, you take it away from them. You're absorbing all the risk. And too many of the lenders say something and it doesn't turn out to be true. In other words, it was something they miscalculated, something maybe on ratios, did something, and they're not thinking about the file, this file. They're talking off the top of their head. But you're going to be nailed for it because you're the one that had the communication with the lender, not the buyer. The next one says, provide option fee and earnest money checks to buyer agent. Well, see, you need to mark that out. As a buyer's agent, that's what you need to always secure, period. No ifs, ands, or buts. We have too many problems where the buyer fails to deposit the earnest money because the buyer agent hasn't had them in their care, custody, and control. The moment you have possession of them, you are obligated, once there is an executed contract, you are obligated to get them receipted and delivered immediately. Okay, that is your job. The trick will hold you to that. Once you have somebody else's check, you have a deadline. Whereas the buyer, if they're the ones that are going to deposit the earnest money, they tend to be procrastinators. And while it says they will be in default of the contract, that's between a buyer and a seller. But you, at all times, if you have a check, you have to deposit. So here's what happens. On Friday, if you have an executed contract, and it's Friday morning, Trek told me by Friday afternoon you had to deposit that earnest money in your contract. And it was funny because we used that exact example. A buyer agent failed to deposit the earnest money checks, and they had them in their possession. And it was their father who was the builder. Oops. Kind of like a bad scenario all the way around. And Trek and I started talking to the attorney, and she said, you know, Marilyn, if they got that at 10 o'clock this morning, by noon I want to see it at the title company receipt. I said, how about one? What if they took a lunch to the title company? She said, okay. Or if you call the marketing rep and they come and get it, that would be fine too, because then you notify them right away and their marketing rep didn't get there until 3 or so. But remember that. That's what Trek said you had to do. The option fee is so critical because the buyer wouldn't have the unrestricted right to terminate if you don't get it receipted within 3 days of the execution. That's what scares me, because that's a job for you. And if you said, oh, the listing agent said for me to drop it in the mail, have any of you ever been told that? Well, don't trust that other agent. They don't work for you. Their best interest is the seller, and they can't wait to nail you for being in default. Okay, I'm not going to do it. Something about it. Thank you.
You gotta take it to the title company
and
just right around the corner.
Nope, I don't want that either. No option fees can be delivered to the title company. The next title company will be treated like the last title companies that accepted an option fee, and I went after them. To this day, the title company writes on a piece of paper, Marilyn, it's already been receipted. The listing agent just asked us to mail this to the seller with something else. They know, because they can't touch that option check. To do so, they will get the rap. That is not their obligation. They cannot touch it at all. That only gets receipted by the seller or the listing broker or agent, okay? Or somebody that the listing agent has said via the phone that go ahead and acknowledge the receipt. The executed date was yesterday. Again, you have to be very particular about these option fees. We don't want a buyer to not have the unrestricted right to terminate. Now, the next one it's the day that all parties sign, okay, and you're in that, still in that mode, if you want to stay up till 11:59 and figure this out, that's fine. But if it's gone to the title company, now we have to get it to the title company, acknowledged with the other agent to make sure everybody's in agreement on the executed date. And then you would have to place it on there and send that back, that page back to the title company, because we'd always want the title company to have that. The next date says closing consummation date. Well, that's paragraph 9. Pretty simple. So it can never be to be determined. It always has to be a day. It can be 30 days from whatever. The next one says executed contract provided to lender or creditor. Now, I don't care if you do it and the buyer does it. I don't care if you send it to them 40 times. Let's just get it there, okay? And it better be timely. That lender needs as much time as possible, and until they get that executed contract, they're not going to be able to say go. The next one says, during your option period, you are advised to do the following. If you are paying cash, have the appraisal done during your option period. You know, there's no provision for a cash purchaser to say, hey, I don't want this property because it didn't appraise. That's not a part of our contracts, okay? The next thing says, schedule all inspections, includes but is not limited to inspections for the house, termite, wood destroy, insects, pool, detection for leaks is different from the pools being serviced, big time, they're totally different. And it says, septic, well, environmental, geophysical, foundation, plumbing, electrical, roofing, and HVAC systems. That's the whole gamut. Now, with the truck inspector is licensed to be able to perform inspections, but they can never penetrate. They can't go into the HVAC system and delve in and find out that the coils are, you know, damaged or it's not functioning there. They cannot penetrate. They just see basically what they observe and what they're able to detect, okay? If an inspector says to a buyer, you need to have a structural engineer come out and evaluate the foundation, you need a roofing company to come out and evaluate it, you need an HVAC person to do it, the buyer has to know they must do that. They must do that for quite a few reasons. Number one, if they don't do that, and they go forward and they close and fund, and then they find out that there was the last leg on the HVAC system, the only people they can be mad at is themselves. Okay? There's never an out for a buyer once they're told by their inspector, you need to do these things. And you're never going to say anything contrary to these things, because that's not your job. All you're going to know is that I better find all these other contractors or vendors and that they give you three or more names so that they can choose and have somebody do something. Foundation is the next part. It says if the seller has provided notice that there were previous foundation issues, that would mean if there was previous foundation repair, okay? It says you cannot rely upon the previous reports. You will need to hire a structural engineer to certify that the foundation is properly functional, that any past repairs were done correctly and are still functioning properly, and secure any warranty. That's the part y'all don't do, and it has to be set, plain and simple. If the inspector says that everything looks great, okay, but there was previous foundation work, your buyer doesn't get a pass. That buyer must hire a structural engineer. And here's the problem that we have. Most of the properties, if the buyers of the property are now the sellers, and when they bought it, the previous owners did the foundation work. So they did it, right? If they can transfer that warranty into their name, they can't pass along the warranty to the next purchaser of their property. And that warranty is only good for the piers and the foundation work that they did, not the entire foundation. And I don't know about you, but you could do three on one end, and they might need 17 on the back section. See, it's the whole foundation. It's not just what was done. It's, is this foundation functioning now? And what they did 10 years ago, is that still working? We have a lawsuit where the listing agent got sued too, big time. And the reason is because the seller said to her, she didn't represent them when they bought the property, okay? Called a banker agent. And so the sellers contacted her to list the property, and they said, oh, we have information, any pipes will be cracked or broken. And it was old piping. That was all cracked. And while we thought the plumbing issue caused the foundation problem, apparently the expert proved us wrong. What do we know? We just were hoping it was just the plumbing and not the actual foundation. Because the way that transferable warranty had been presented when we got it from the seller, it wasn't valid. So if you don't put it on the market, if you don't get an active listing agreement that will commence and be an MLS, you can have it start and then commence later and you explain the delay, but you better have in your possession all the documentation. Because you are the one passing along what they give you, okay? And so it's hard for you as a listing agent to kind of get them all in sync and know that this won't work because you never did transfer. There is no transferable warranty. And the sellers put that on the seller's disclosure. So they in their own hand wrote that in, and it was not true. And that's what the listing agent was trying to prove. Well, if you've got one, go ahead and give it to us so we can get it to the other party when we get an offer. So again, you have to be very, very careful about these types of things. That's why we say it has to be a structural engineer to come down. Yes, sir?
In the highlighted area in the last sentence there, where you are to get a structural engineer, the last part of that says, and secure any warranty. Are you asking the structural engineer to do that? When it says, and secure any warranty.
That would be of the previous foundation work.
Who is doing that?
The buyer is required to by the contract. The seller does not secure that warranty for them. They provide them the details of how that buyer can go get the warranty. But that is not a function of the seller. It is the warranty that's given based on the foundation work that was completed by the foundation company. And again, I am going to tell you that that was critical because we were in mediation and the mediator was there and the mediator came in and she had just finished in the room with the buyers. The buyers are saying, the listing agent Keller Williams are at fault because they did not provide the warranty information and secure the warranty for the buyers. That's what the mediator, when she came back in the room. And I said, well, unfortunately, the buyers don't know the contract because in paragraph 7, it says that they have to secure the warranty. She says, can you show me that? I said, I sure can. I pulled up on my computer and showed it. She goes, well, they ought to hire you to be a consultant. You know the contract very well. And I said, well, we're agents. That's our job. That's what we know. So she left our room, and we didn't get hit as badly as all the other rooms because I was able to prove that it wasn't the seller's job. It wasn't the listing agent's job. It was the buyer's job. The next one, schedule inspections with the day completed. So you're going to put all that once they make that decision. You've given them your handy-dandy list that you have. The next one says acquire insurance bids for your property. This is important only during the option period. And why is it so important? The buyer cannot terminate if they don't get favorable premium rates for their insurance. Unless they're in the termination option. They couldn't say, if the lender said, oh, the property managed for ability, and the buyer says, but I'm not going to pay $6,000 a year. The previous seller only paid $100. You know the difference? The buyer doesn't have an option to terminate. If there isn't, they'd be in fault. So do it during the option period. And remember, we always recommend flood insurance, no matter which flood zone the property is in. Verify windstorm insurance requirements as well. Also, you need to ask your insurance agent to produce a flood report. That is a certified underwriting report that shows all the previous claims that are made on the property, what was paid out, those type of things. And what happens is if the buyer chooses a company for a quote, that is what we call a non-admitted company, they don't care about previous claims because they're not admitted. Only really good companies would make a Kluger report happen immediately when they got a quote to quote on the property. But
They'll go in, it looks so much smaller, no, it's old. But they kind of get that feeling once they know that, well, and how we know as a buyer's agent is the buyer will say, I'm only going to pay X number of dollars a square foot. That's all I want to offer. The moment you hear that, man, you're going to be saying, okay, whoo, stop everything. This property and this contract are not conditioned on square footage. If you want to be able to terminate once you find out the square footage, you better have it measured during your auction period. And that's what they would have to do. Because they probably aren't going to get the appraisal out there because they're in the auction, they may not even go for. The other one is verify schools. Years ago, it used to be school districts. And it could be if you are in a situation where the school districts are split in a development, and this side of the street goes to one school district, and yet, have y'all ever heard of that? I lived in a neighborhood like that in St. Louis, and it's amazing because my son, who is an only child, all the kids that lived to our right all went to a different school, and all the kids down the lane on the left went to another school. So he wanted to always be able to play and be in school with kids that were in his neighborhood. And we were not in a neighborhood that could accomplish that because of this play. And I had never, I was in Houston most of my life, and I'd never heard of such a thing. But they would split a neighborhood down a driveway, but they do that. Also, some people want their children in certain schools, like certain high schools, certain middle schools, and you've got to tell them, you check on that. Don't rely upon you to be the one that says, absolutely, they're in this school. The next one says, verify taxes and exemptions on property. That's important. You've given the buyer the tax assessment that you have as a public record, but they're going to need to verify if those exemptions and other things, because what happened before was a lender very close to closing found out that the property had over 65 and disabled exemptions. Didn't check all of this early on at the very end and found out that the ratios would affect the buyer if they were not individually approved to be able to go forward. They had no provision to terminate because they were individually no longer approved because of that. So you want to make sure you verify that. And the lender tried to say it was the agent's fault. That was a lender job there. It was not a buyer agent job. And the buyer agent was able to prove it because, see, we require it to be uploaded and they had the buyer's initial. Smart. Because the buyers had a copy of it and the buyers had an initial. Most of the time, the lenders will catch that, hopefully. But just if you see these exemptions, you're going to bring that to everybody's attention because you want to make sure that you pointed that out because they may not be looking for that. The next one says contact local police departments to obtain information about criminal activity. That is in our general information notice to a buyer. We tell them to do that and show them the website we go through for various things. But they need to know if that's their concern. They're going to have to figure that out, not you. That's not your job. The next one says verify restrictions and any violations with property owners association. You do that during the auction period because most of you are negotiating in behalf of buyers and sellers where the buyers do not have the contingency for receiving those documents from a seller. Okay, they use A4 a lot, we see. So you will need them to do that. And the reason I say that is because we've had a lot of issues where the buyer finds out that the seller is in violation, didn't disclose that to them, and they're required to. It's in section 5, if there's any violations that the seller is aware of, do that. But most of the time, what we find out is once the association knows it's under contract, that's when they send them out and tell the owner, you have all these violations. Until that time, they kind of just go along, and if you've got a neighbor to turn to you in because you leave your garbage cans in and out, that kind of thing gets taken care of. But for the most part, they don't, and they do that. Those neighbors are like that. And I lived in South Africa, and the worst thing, we have a 7 to 8 hour difference, and the HOA called us
tell the seller, you're going forward. You're going to buy your house. Okay? And that's important. You need to know this is a different step. And it says you must receive your closing disclosures from your lender by a day. This is on the time limits. Or you will not be able to close on the closing day. This is a fact, folks. With this 3-day waiting period, if they don't get those closing disclosures on that first day on there, they're not going to be able to close. Because you have to wait 3 full days, and then on that 4th day, you can close. So we know that is a fact. So if your lender is behind at this point, after the auction period, that buyer is now in a horrible situation. They may have to go to the seller trying to negotiate an extension for a closing day, and this is not going to be good. It says, I recommend that on the first day of the 3-day waiting period, you take time off from work to review and be at the lender's office for any questions or verification so that you can approve or provide proper notice to the lender. Okay? That's the way we want them to work. That's the best, it's actually the best interest of the buyer and the seller. Period. That you pay attention to it on the first day. Check and request the status from your lender periodically and provide any additional documentation promptly. Well, that's in third party. Their duty is to provide that documentation promptly. If they don't and will pass the third party, you're going to tell them, look, they asked for this, and this is the condition they needed. You better get it to them like yesterday. That's their job. That's their duty. They could be held in default if they don't. The next one says, choose the residential service contractor. Notify me with your decision. You give them all the information about all the various ones. They've done their research, and now you need to get it because you're going to need all that information a lot sooner than the last week of closing because that time tolerance have just advanced because of the CFPB. So the next one says, your deadline for individual approval and notice to a seller is day. It's number of days in third party, but I convert it to a day. It says verify with your lender, one, that you are individually approved, two, you are receiving the same terms as on the third party financing agreement for credit approval, and three, if you want to request an extension for approval from the seller, because there is not a certainty that the seller will ever grant it. If I were a listing agent, I would never advise the seller to extend it. There's no reason why the seller would extend it and give a provision of buyer to terminate and walk away and get their earnest money. That doesn't make any sense. The seller wouldn't do that under any circumstances. It doesn't mean that the buyer can't make a hard decision, but no seller is forced to extend that or approve that. And it says if you are not individually approved or did not receive the same terms as they provided, you will need to immediately notify me of your action regarding this contract. I will need to know if you're going to terminate, proceed forward with the contract and risk losing your earnest money, or if you're not individually approved, or will be sending an amendment to the seller for extension of number of days for individual approval. So these are what you needed to always say to them and put it in writing, because that's their options. They either can terminate because they didn't get the terms and they're not individually approved. They can risk going forward and saying, hey, I'll take the risk and I'll lose my earnest money if I'm not individually approved. Or they can say, well, can I go back to the seller and ask them to give me a few more days until I get a better feel on this approval? Okay, so those are their options. You have to be clear of giving them their options. And then they're selecting whatever they want to choose. The next one says review the commitment. That's your job. When you get it from the title company, it usually gives you a recap of some of the schedules or issues that have come up, what needs to be cleared, what the parties need to do. You need to review that and then review that with your buyer. If there are any objections, they have to put them in writing. And that's in the form of an amendment to make it a part of the contractual obligation by the seller. And if the seller cannot cure it, the buyer has a provision to terminate. And that's how you have to do any of the objections for the commitment. Review the survey. You're not going to review a survey unless they got a new one and bought, paid for it, or the seller's paid for it. An existing survey is not their survey. And you all know how I feel about that part. So, but if they paid for it, or if they had the sellers give them one, you will need to review the survey then. Because at that point in time, they have a very limited time to put their objections in an amendment. get drunker and they get to do those types of things. The next one says if there are repairs or replacements, the seller agreed to arrange for reinspection by an inspector. So many times the buyer agent fails to make the buyer understand that nobody gets to approve those repairs and make sure they were done right except the inspector. You know, I love the listing agent, and not the listing agent, but the buyer agent will say, oh, the buyer and I were there and we were going through all the receipts and everything looked fine. I said, really? Since when did you become an inspector? Is the buyer an inspector? Well, no, we have the receipts and we went and we flushed the toilet and everything worked. No, that's not how it works. Who would be the only one who could say those repairs were done wrong? The inspector. The only one. If a buyer took your word, don't worry, we'll go and check it out a lot before we go to closing. If you are going to be involved in fixing them. Because that's not what you say. They need to have an inspector make sure that they were done properly. If you at any time make them think that you can check it yourself or go by and verify it, no. And you might be able to check to make sure they painted something, if it was negotiated or repairs and holes, you know, you can look at those and see that they were done right. But anything else, mechanical or anything that would be done with the HVAC system, the plumbing, the electrical, you don't get to say they did the right thing. And it's very true. Amen. They will have to pay for that reinspection. I don't know of any inspector who comes out free for that. Normally, what they do at the time that they're calling all the inspectors to find out if they're available and if they want to use them, they'll say, I will need you to reinspect too. Can you give me your combined rate? And that's what they do. And that's a very positive thing. We want them to do it. If they're not going to do it, I want to see it in writing somewhere. They can write it on this little form, you know, they have the ability to do that, or in an email. But we want to make sure that they know that that's their job, that they need to get it re-inspected by the inspector. The next one says, in the event there is a delay with the lender sending you the closing disclosures for the 3-day waiting period, notify me immediately. Here's what I'm so afraid of, is we're going to be 5 days before closing. So that would be the day before those documents are to arrive, right? And you're getting kind of nervous and you've left a message with the lender and the lender is not returning your phone call. You call that buyer and say, look, your lender is not returning my call. You need to find out from your lender today. Are they going to be sending you your closing disclosures tomorrow? Because if they are delayed, they have caused you to be in a very difficult position to go back and negotiate with the seller. Because the seller at that point would be within their right to say no. But what the seller cannot say no to is if once that 3-day waiting period begins and the buyer finds something and the lender has now declared that it is federally mandated to start the 3-day waiting period over. But not that it's never begun. You see the difference? That buyer could be in trouble and the lender messed up.
Marilyn, if on the 10-day extended, if the disclosure has not been sent to the buyer, the seller still have the right to extend it 10 days? Or is it once the disclosure is sent to them, then they have the 10 days, the option of the 10 days to extend it?
That would only be if it's a federally mandated 3-day waiting period to start over, then the buyer and seller could agree to extend the contract for up to 10 days.
Then they don't have to until that's sent.
Right. Okay. Yeah, they're not going to do anything until the lender declares that it is comes under the federal mandate, okay? But what I'm talking about is we haven't even got to the 3-day beginning. Do you see the difference? And I know this is going to happen. The lender is going to get that call, and they're not ready. And they're going to say, you need to go to the seller and extend the closing. Those are hard conversations, I would think, that will be in place.
In that case, we'll be okay with the extended loans all 3 days.
Are you extending for however long the parties need to agree to?
Oh, okay.
It has nothing to do with a federal mandate. This is prior to that 3-day waiting period beginning. We already know that the lender hasn't met the deadline. The next one says, verify with creditor and lender the amount you will need for closing and secure cashier's check. And one of the agents in the earlier session said, and make that check out to the title company. Well, she was a listing contract and reach, I'm not going to close. The seller's attorney said it doesn't say that in 7A, and I'm thinking, okay, we got so many attorneys with different opinions. So basically, what I would recommend, we have very little room to write anything in special provisions, but I think something that is not covered specifically in the contract and can be inferred, which is what attorneys do, they interpret, you would put in special provisions that a buyer has a right to do a final walkthrough and acceptance of the property before 24 hours before closing. Something like that, where they're going to say it's their final walkthrough and acceptance, okay? Because the truth is, you have to accept this property before you go and close. And if you don't, you're going to have to sign a little form that said, I accept the property, but I didn't go and physically walk the property, you know? And this is real important, because every lawsuit we've ever had, the attorney has immediately asked us for the buyer's final walkthrough and acceptance. The first document. And it was funny, I kept going, and the insurance company, before they would accept the claim for the agent, they wanted to see a copy of that, signed by the buyer. Listing agent, buyer agent, it didn't matter. And they felt that that form was provided that would give confidence that the party did accept it and went to closing. That's what they want to see. They want to see where that individual said, I accept it. Because if they can prove that they declined it for reasons that were not practical, they can say, well, you accepted the property. You went, you knew it was there because you saw it. And that's the truth. That's what they're trying to get at. And with our new contract in paragraph, as is in paragraph 7, where they changed that language, that's because of those lawsuits where it did prevail, that the buyer did accept the property as it was. And that's why you don't ever do repairs after it's closed and funded, because see, the buyer already accepted it. And if the buyer agent misled the buyer into thinking that everything will be fine, they could be liable, because that's one of the issues on that. Okay, the last thing we're going to go through is the time limits.
I got a question. I'm going to get
No, that one would not be, that would be the document. He's asking, is this approval for a DA, the checklist? Because this is a dynamic form and it's being created and changed the whole way, this would be the documents that you would have in the documentation folder. For all the communications and your emails, it would be through on that. The addendums definitely are, and your CFPB checklist is something that you need to use. If you have problems on your transaction and you didn't use it, well, that's going to be a problem for you. There won't be a requirement. It's a good list for you to be able to use as reference. Okay, does everybody have a copy of the time limits?
Where's the change?
Yes.
So we use the
all the way through the transaction.
You say receipt, buy, and sign, but who actually has to sign this?
The buyer.
The buyer, okay. So we don't give them a copy once they sign it?
Yeah, it should stay in Dotloop. If they don't use Dotloop, then you'll have to do it back and forth. But if it's in Dotloop, you can each go into that document and update it and change things and share it with the other party, okay? Time limits. Everybody's got the copy?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. On this time limits, you're going to see that it has some information that you know. Address, property, address. And then the very first box that you're going to complete will be contract executed. Whoops. If you go to Mayday and you don't see one, you can't go any further. Okay, so this is one good reason to make you understand that the execution date better be done very fast, because if you don't have it, you're going to need to get that established and settled before you give them your time limits. Again, that is a date that you have to plug in, because every other date goes off of that date. Okay, the next one is the closing date. Pretty simple, that's paragraph 9. The next one we have, it says, closing disclosures delivered by. It'll be a drop-down box, and it'll say E for email and M for mail. sale, okay?
If you're the listing agent.
The listing agent, you're gonna find out, that's one of your jobs, that cheat sheet. You're gonna ask the buyer's agent all those questions if they don't give you that information on the conditional letter.
But anyway, once you do E, it's gonna calculate a day to the first day of the three-day waiting period. The closing disclosures have to be delivered, okay? So what you're gonna know is you see that day, but you have to manually adjust it if it's Sundays or legal holidays. Okay, you'll have to add to it. So it's got 6-9 in it now. So if it was on a Sunday and one of those days, you'd have to add it and make it 6-10. Okay, so you're gonna have to manually adjust that date. That's the only one that you would have to adjust. Now the next field says, if repairs or treatments negotiated, they have to be completed by. Remember how I told the sellers they have to do it early within the 2 weeks of the closing date? That's gonna be there, calculated. It's not gonna change. It's there as a reference to let everybody know the real repairs and everything need to really be completed by this day, okay? The next thing that you'll see is it will show you commitment delivered by. Now that's per our contract. They have 20 days to deliver the commitment. So that's gonna be a day there. We always receive the commitment ahead of that. But if you don't have a commitment by that day, you better get on it and find out what's going on, okay? So it's a trigger for you to remember that the commitment has to be given by the contract by this day. If not, there's some provisions that are in the contract that allow it to be extended, okay, for the delivery. The next one says the survey, number of days. Now again, this is only for paragraph 61, 2, or 3. You negotiate number of days. You'll enter the days in there. And then it gives you the ability to know that if you didn't receive it by that day, there's a problem. Now there's a default basically in paragraph 6 regarding the survey. The next one is the, what is it? Written objections due by. In paragraph 6D, at various times, you're gonna get the survey at a different time from the commitment, but whatever your number of days for objection, the buyer has to object in writing by those number of days after they receive it, okay? So that's what you have to always remember. If they don't object within those number of days, they're deemed to have waived it, and so it'll be on the burden of the buyer. So again, as a buyer's agent, you want to pay attention to that because you don't want that to ever pass. The next one says the seller's disclosure notice number of days. If they negotiated 0, because it says they have received it, you'll put 0 in there and it'll show the day that they got it based on the contract date. If it's to be delivered, which is very deadly for the seller, to deliver it because it gives the buyer a free walk. Once they do receive it or if they don't receive it, they can walk it too. The next one is, right, I'm sorry, I'm trying to read upside down, it's not very easy. We have a provision now, if the seller has a tenant under a lease, in paragraph 10, they are required to submit all the documents within 7 days of the execute date. And because it's not a fill in the blank, agent listing agents are missing that. So I wanted it on here because I want both the listing agent to know that the landlord has to give it by that time and the buyer has to receive it by that time. So it's a time limit in the contract and it's kind of snuck in there and not very many people pay attention to it because nobody filled it in. It's not a fill in the blank. It is part of the standard language in the contract. The next one says option fee received by. Yeah, based on that executed date, so I see 3 days add to it, and that receipt has to be received by that date, or the buyer does not have the unrestricted right to terminate. So we never want that to ever go by and not give that buyer the unrestricted right to terminate. The next one says the option period, number of days, and then the option ends. So what happens is you're going to fill in how many days they chose in paragraph 23, and then it gives you the date for the end of the option period. And it ends at 11:59 p.m. for the contract right now.
is no contingency for the buyer to receive the earnest money if they're not in default agreement. So that's the final day they would have, unless they extended it to an amendment. The next one is the Property Owners Association, mandatory number of days. Like I said, most of you are negotiating paragraph A4, which is that the buyer doesn't require delivery of the documents by the seller. But if you use 1, 2, or 3, there are a number of days. And what that means is that if they're not received by that day, the buyer has provisions to terminate. Okay, so that's why you want to pay attention to those dates of real court, because you don't want them to think that they don't have a provision to terminate. Now, you notice that buyers and sellers can sign this. As I said, what I would do if I were a buyer's agent, I would say, okay, based on everything we've had the lender provide and what you want, I have run a simulation based on if we had an executed date of today. This is what your performance would look like. Can you do this? You're not going on vacation. You're not getting married. You're going on a honeymoon. And then for our listing agent, when they receive an offer, you're going to run it. And you're going to show the seller, I did this based on we reached agreement today and we have an executed contract. This is what your performance for the time frame would look like for you closing on this property. Use it a million times. You can do it all different ways, but it gives the individuals more of a picture of all of the dates that they are required to provide or fulfill or sustain. And the interesting part is they're extracted from various paragraphs. It's not easy for them to find them on their own. And I know this because the agents have a hard enough time trying to identify them. So you can imagine a buyer not knowing the form, how are they going to know what the number of days a third party means? And so the more you use this and you provide it to them, the better it will help you in making sure that everybody understands it. If they're not an auditory learner or they're not a visual learner, they're going to see this and have you explain it, and they're going to be able to understand calendar and dates, and we all know that. Again, all this begins on October 3rd. What I recommend to you is on October 1st, you get a listing, and it has not sold. You're going to go back and visit with the sellers and kind of set the tone, and you probably have already told them a little bit about it, but now you're going to have the addendum that you can visit with them and have them acknowledge that. And the reason, it'll just be a good way, just in the event that they get an offer after October 3rd. It's October 3rd and beyond. Anything that is on the books to close does not have any impact. If you executed a contract on October 1st, they will not come under these guidelines. But I am going to tell you, based on what the lenders and the appraisers and the underwriters are doing, they're already working under the guidelines. It's just that it's not official until October 3rd. So, again, just be cognizant of this. And for the first few times that you go through this, you're going to do a lot of reading to them. It's going to be what you're going to need to do, because they're going to go, what? I don't understand. What is this thing? And a lot of times it's just reading what we've provided or kind of review for them. My biggest concern is that you know, if you're a listing agent, you should know what you should be doing on the buyer's agent side. And that's why you have all these documents. So you'll kind of have a good sense of, and this is what we need to review with the lender. I need to get confirmation from the buyer agent about this, how they're going to deliver. This is going to give you a lot of information that you really need to provide to yourself. Even though it's a buyer's type of information, it's going to be critical that you still understand this and know all of this prior to them making a decision on accepting that offer. Yes, ma'am.
Marilyn, are we going to need these downloaded to DotLoop for compliance, or is this just for our use to help us?
The listing addendum and the buyer rep addendum are mandatory, and Nicole is getting them converted right now. When she gets them in DotLoop, she's going to send me an email telling me where they are. And I'll send it to Veronica, and she'll send it out to all of you. The forms are there, and this is where she has placed them in which masters. Because the time limits is going to be under the Market Center intranet, under documents. There's a folder called